Hey everybody, it's Brandon, the Weekend Cruiser, where I go on a weekend cruise just about every weekend. And one of the advantages of doing that, especially staying with the same lines, you all know that I stay with Royal Caribbean for most of my cruises, is I get to know the crew members here aboard the ship. And so with that, I'm very fortunate to have Chris Trudo joining me today. He agreed to do my very first interview, so I hope you all find this helpful. If you have some additional questions you want, make sure you're leaving those down in the comments and we'll see if we can get those answered for you as well. But hopefully this is a great conversation with Chris today. All right, welcome Chris.
Thank you very
much.
Thank
you.
Yes, thank you very much for having me. Again, my name is Chris, the cruise director here on board the Freedom of the Seas out of Miami with Royal Caribbean International. Just a little bit about me. I am 30 years old. This is my second contract as cruise director with Royal Caribbean, but I did start from the bottom. I did cruise director staff, then moved up to activities manager, and then in the return to service of the company coming out of our shutdown, I actually had a different role that was called Healthy Return to Service Entertainment Protocol Producer that was in charge of making sure that all of our entertainment protocols were in place on the ships that I was on. And I also did liaise with some of our other team members in our Miami office to help retrofit certain protocols to other ships as they came back, so on and so forth.
That's awesome. Which of those jobs was your favorite?
Ooh, that's a very difficult question. I really love the job I'm in right now.
I mean,
it's my favorite job right now. I love cruise director. I feel as though I was someone that from just as a young age, I'm an only child, so I was always very much do your homework, follow the rules, this, that, the other. So I was, I guess, kind of groomed to be, I would say, maybe in a management position, maybe. Of course, obviously, like I said, I went through the ranks and I did everything to the best of my abilities. Each job offered something different to my personal life, to my work, professional life, being in different itineraries with the ships here on board. But I would say out of all of them so far, my favorite is cruise director.
That's fantastic. So, I mean, if you're doing a cruise director job, how long are your contracts? I know that everybody here has a little bit different of a length. What do you normally find for your contracts?
So generally, for someone at the cruise director level or a management level, it's a 4-month contract on and then 2 months off. And then 4 months on and then 2 months off. Obviously, there is always room for change and things do change. And so, for example, I'm going to do a 5-month contract this time, but that's because I understand the company needs and I'm willing to offer my time and assistance to make sure that we have everything covered.
Yeah, so you mentioned different ranks there. What rank is a cruise director then?
Cruise director, so I do have stripes in regards to onboard, especially with different like naval vessels or even just any sailing vessel. There's different stripe levels. Yep. So I have 3.5 stripes, which is quite
that
up
is
there.
Certainly up there. So, being a cruise director, what is it that you actually do? What does that job entail?
I love this question because it's face value. When a guest is coming on board and they see a cruise director, it's very much of the entertainment point of view, being on stage, keeping the guests informed, keeping it light, keeping it funny. Yeah. But a lot of my roles, actually behind the scenes that people don't see, I mean, it's probably, I would say, maybe a 70-30% split, where 30% of my time is devoted to the front of house responsibilities and 70% of my time is devoted to the back of house. So, for example, I mean, I'm the one that creates the entertainment program. So setting the show times and working with my other managers in my division to schedule activities and live music and working as a team to really create what we call a guest flow. So thinking, okay, if the guest has a dining at this time, after they're done, where are they going to go? What can they do? Mm-hmm. If they're done with that, then where do they go? If they have a later dining time and they're coming back from port at this time, and we're taking all of that into account.
The flow of people.
Exactly.
So, well, I was talking with one of my friends last night, and she was asking, how much flexibility do you get on deciding what programs or activities that you actually do? So do you have like a bucket or an idea basket that you can pull from, or do you have free rein to say, hey, I think this would be a really cool opportunity to launch here on Freedom?
There is a lot of opportunity for us to do what we want to do as an individual on board. There obviously are things that we have SOPs, things, standard operating procedures, things that we have to do.
70s night,
I mean, laser tag, love and marriage, things like that are staples,
tickets.
You know what I mean? When it comes to some of those maybe more specialized, like the types of trivias or the types of music trivias, there's always some element of approval that we would need just so that we're not breaking any copyright laws.
Yeah.
But we still do have the ability to say, you know what, I really want to host this type of activity, or I think this type of game show would be really cool. And then we, as a crew member, any crew member on board can write an SOP and get it submitted. And then if it gets approved, then we can implement it.
That's really great.
Yeah.
So in thinking of all those different activities that you do, what would be your most favorite and least favorite of all the activities you put on?
Oh, my most
favorite.
Where
does towel folding line up there?
Towel folding is right in the middle, right in the middle. My personal favorite to both watch and to host would be The Quest.
Oh, yeah.
The Quest. It's such a fun game show. It's an adult game show, but it's so much fun. There's such a high energy, and it's very quick and fast-paced, and it's super interactive, and that's what I like about it. It's that anyone that's in there, they can get extremely interactive, and they mm-hmm. can really get into it, or they can sit back and watch, and every now and again, they'll offer something, and you know, it's a really a personal choice of how invested yeah. they want to get.
Is Quest back on the ship yet?
Not quite yet. It's still one of the activities
that... Do we have an ETA there?
We don't, but all we're hearing is that it's coming back soon.
Perfect.
Not a specific date, but soon.
It's also a guest favorite as well,
of course,
so that's why
of
I
course.
Asked that.
And I mean, it's one of those, it's a crowd pleaser. It's a crowd yeah. favorite. So we know as a company that we want it back eventually, but there are obviously some things that we just want to make sure from our end are covered, especially as we are still returning to service, still following certain protocols yeah. here and there. And we want to make sure that everyone, both crew and guests, are kept safe in the current situation. So that's one of the reasons that it's not yet back, but it will come back.
Yep.
I know that the conversation is there. Now, least favorite in regards to activity, I would say probably something that I just don't necessarily have any interest in. You know, I don't necessarily think any one particular, but like, mm-hmm. if I'm gonna host a trivia that me personally, I have no invested interest in that specific topic, I would probably find it boring. Personally.
Right.
Right. So I would say something like that. I was always, as a staff, as a manager, and even as a in my current role, I always try to find the fun and the light and the positive side of everything that we do, right? From gangway to trivias to game mm-hmm. shows to everything, right? There's always something to be said about just the fact that we are allowed to interact with the guests.
Yeah. Now, one of the differences there, interacting with guests on a weekend cruise or a three-night, they go very, very quick. What would you tell people that are looking at doing a weekend cruise, a three-night sailing to the Bahamas for the first time? Mm-hmm. How is this different than a traditional seven-night sailing?
Well, okay, so everything is jam-packed in, right? We offer as much as we possibly can because we want everyone to make the most of their mm-hmm. time on board, right? And we want them to have options. On a seven-night cruise, it's a little bit stretched out. There's still plenty to do. Seven-night cruises are absolutely phenomenal. You get so many great itineraries, so many great activities, and the ships are gorgeous. I mean, this ship itself is also gorgeous, but it is much quicker. So definitely, I mean, we try and get as much in as possible. We keep it very fast. We keep it light. And from a cruise director standpoint, I don't have a whole lot of time to interact with the guests. I do my absolute best to go out there and make an impression and keep everyone informed, because that's the one thing about a three-night is keeping people informed, because by the time you may even have a chance to tell them about something, it's either done or it's the end of the cruise.
Yeah. So that's a great point. You know, what advice would you offer to somebody that wants to try to do it all? How do they make sure that they're not missing those opportunities when they get on the ship?
So we used to have something called the Cruise Compass, which we still do, but as a company, we are still working towards saving the waves and using less paper, reducing our paper consumption. So we have this amazing tool called the Royal Caribbean app. And all of our activities, our daily program, are mm-hmm. loaded onto there. Now, the difference between the Cruise Compass, which was the paper itinerary that you would get delivered every day, which people would highlight or mark and do the whole thing, you can basically do the same thing on the app, where you could just slide over and you add it to your own personal calendar.
You can reserve your reservation.
Right, exactly. You reserve your reservation, you add it to your own personal calendar, you create your own itinerary, and I mean, it even gives you notifications on your phone, and that would be a huge thing that I recommend. Personally, mm-hmm. I cruise frequently, and that is one thing that I like to do. On the first day, I'll look at all the days of the cruise and think, I want to go to that, I want to go to that, yep. I want to go to that, and then I'll build my own itinerary from there. Maybe that's the cruise director in me being like, I'm, you know, structured. There are plenty of people out there that just want to go and experience, and they just go with the flow, yeah. and then, you know, like I said, the guests flow, and they just pop in, they pop out, they enjoy, that's totally valid. It's your vacation.
I love hearing the fact that you go on cruises as well. You're
do.
Part of the Crown and Anchor Society.
I am.
Proud member. So what's your level there?
So I'm a Diamond member.
Diamond member. So what is it like to come on a cruise as a guest? How is that different for you in turning off that mindset of I'm the cruise director?
So just get maybe a bit more backstory. So when I was a kid, we used to cruise all the time because my grandparents owned a travel agency. And so we were always going to test a new ship or mm-hmm. test a new itinerary. And I have cruised with quite a few cruise lines, quite frankly. And prior to joining, it is my personal preferred choice for vacation, because I think you get everything in one package.
Yep.
You get your accommodation, your food, your entertainment, activities, and you get to visit multiple ports of call or places around the world within one vacation without having to book a hotel here, then transportation, and book a hotel here, transportation. And it really just gives you a very great overview of what the world has to offer. So that obviously, up until coming on board, it was my preferred choice. That's why I wanted to work on board. Now, obviously, having worked on board and coming, and I still cruise, every vacation between my contracts, I go on a cruise. I have a cruise booked for my upcoming vacation. I go in, I turn off. At least I try to turn off.
it's in your blood.
Exactly. I'm not the authority of the program on that ship, so I'm just there to enjoy. Generally, I go with my parents because they love to cruise as well. So it's our family vacation, and we just kind of hang out and do as much as we can together. You know what I mean? I take advantage of the ports of call when we're there. I go out and we do as much as we can.
More importantly, do you get your 4 free drink coupons when you're working
No. Not while I'm on board.
Not while you're on contract. Okay.
No.
Just making sure. But as a guest, you do.
As a guest, I do. Yes.
And you mentioned briefly there, different ports that you go to. So thinking of the weekend cruise here, I mean, we go to Nassau. You have the Nassau Bahamas. You have Coco Cay. You've got a Sea Day. Uh-huh. You know, what would be your favorite port that you would say here?
Favorite port. My personal favorite port. Does Miami count?
Miami would absolutely count, yeah.
So obviously for the Freedom, our turnaround porter, the place that we come back to, we get our guests off, they disembark, we get our new guests on, that's our turnaround port. That's Miami, and I think Miami is spectacular. I mean, I'm from Florida. I love Miami. It's such an upbeat city. There's such a great culture there. I really love Miami. I mean, there's a lot of great stuff out there. The food is great, and it's such a melting pot, which I really enjoy.
That's awesome.
If you're thinking of just ports of call in regards to the ports that we visit, I cruised before, and so I've seen Coco Cay, what it was prior to the perfect day at Coco Cay, which is what it is now, when it used to be a tender port.
Oh, yeah.
It was literally just a beach, and they had great things at the time, but they have just gone so far and above, well, I don't think what anyone could have ever expected it to have been, and I think it is probably one of the defining features for Royal Caribbean as a company.
Yeah, I'd agree with that. I mean, I used to come to Coco Cay all the time when we tendered, and I was really worried that, you know, they were going to overdo it and make it feel too commercialized. Mm. And there's definitely more commercial items over there to do,
right.
But they did a great job hiding it within nature, and so you feel like it all kind of blends together, and you still get that island vibe. So fantastic job to Royal Caribbean
on
that.
I totally agree.
Thinking of, you know, the complaints that you get here on the ship, I'll change gears a little bit. You know, what's the most common complaint that you get, and what would you proactively tell people? Just go ahead and know X before you come on a cruise ship.
That's a bit of a difficult question because it changes from itinerary to itinerary, from ship to ship, what the ship offers. I would say do as much research as you can before. There's a really good...
YouTube videos are a great place for that.
It's a great, great one. I mean, and honestly, even prior to getting this job, before I was a crew staff, that's how I learned about it, was watching YouTube videos about people that worked on board that were giving advice to people that were interested in it. So I would say that YouTube videos are actually a very, very good tool to use. I mean, a free tool, you know what I mean? Every time I go on a cruise, my mom and I will sit down in front of the TV and we will watch a ship tour of the ship that we're going on, so we can already know when we get on, I want to go do this, I want to go do this, I want to do this. I would say that, yes, just knowledge in general, especially in a 3 and 4 day, because time can fly by very fast, is to plan ahead. I know we briefly touched on this already, but when you come on, go straight away. If you want to make reservations for your dining in the specialty restaurants, do that, because sometimes they do book up. I mean, on ships that require reservations for shows, same thing. On the 3 and 4 day cruise on the Freedom, we don't require. It's a first come, first seated. Mm-hmm. But there are some ships out there in the fleet that do require reservations, and that goes for shows or activities in general. Again, it's ship specific. So I would say, you know, to plan ahead and make the most of your time, especially right now. Prior to the shutdown, there, you know, were ways to make reservations online on what's called the cruise planner, pre-cruise planner. And I know that has shifted slightly, especially for certain areas like shows, especially, you know, that we have returned to service. Reservations are made on board, solely on board, when you're on board, either by visiting the box office or through the Royal Caribbean app. So I would say plan as much as you can before about what you want to do, and then when you get on board, execute that in your first day, so then you can use the rest of your time to enjoy.
Yep. Now, being a Pinnacle member with Royal Caribbean, I'll ask this question delicately. Who do you think, what tier of Crown and Anchor Society complains the most, or do you hear the most feedback from, would you say?
Ooh, which tier in the Crown and Anchor Society?
Or it could be a first-time cruiser who hasn't quite made it there yet.
Right, okay. I would say that the ones that give us feedback, both positive and negative, most frequently would be those that are right in the middle.
Okay.
Those are, you know, not necessarily one specific tier, but that have cruised a couple times, they come to know what to expect, and if something doesn't happen, what their expectations are, if we, for whatever reason, don't meet their expectations, they are a bit more vocal about it.
Yeah.
But they also are the ones that are, like, they're 100% willing to say when things are a really good time, and they're willing to give that positive feedback.
That's fantastic to hear. So everybody take note, he did not say Pinnacle members there.
I did not. but no, but I mean, again, just from my personal experience, with Pinnacle guests, they know what our product is, right? They've cruised so frequently that they
Very
know what
so.
The product is. So their expectations are set in stone. And even just myself as a Diamond member, I mean, I work for the company, but every time I go on a new ship or a new itinerary, my expectations may change. And whether or not something meets my expectations or not is up to me to decide when I'm there. But I would always be willing to give both the positive and negative feedback.
Yeah. Now, your role also allows you to get to know a lot of the headliners that come on board that are rotating contract to contract, you know, sailing to sailing sometimes. You know, singers, musicians, you know, a band favorite, for instance. You know, would you have any favorites there that you've run into or a good story you could share from the headliners that come on board?
Ooh, obviously in my current role as cruise director, this is my second contract as cruise director.
Yep.
So we do see a lot of headliners, you know, it's on a rotation. It's like a 3 to 4 cruise basis. So if you're thinking of that for a 3 and 4 day, every 2 weeks, more or less every 2 weeks. But I've seen as a staff and as a manager, I've seen some incredible. I personally, I mean, I come from a theater background. I come from a performance background. So I love all the headliners because they all offer something different. I really enjoy a cappella groups for some reason. I don't know why. They just click with me, a cappella groups. Or like tribute singers or singers that do a show that is specifically to an artist or a genre.
Yep.
But obviously, again, that would be for an artist or genre that I would identify with enjoying.
Yes.
You know what I mean? So specifically that. But I've seen some phenomenal ventriloquists. I've seen some phenomenal jugglers. I've seen some phenomenal comedians. And they all offer something different. But their product, their performance, their product, what they are offering for our guests, I mean, that is what I enjoy.
Yeah.
I just enjoy seeing the audience laughing, have a good time, standing ovations. I mean, when they get up out of their seats, when they clap, when they scream, that means they have done their job and we have done our job and they are entertained.
Absolutely. Now, you're also, a lot of people probably noticed this, you're from Florida, you are an American. We don't see many Americans working on the cruise ships. Why is that?
I feel like that's a very interesting question. So I feel as though there might be more than you would expect, but in roles that you don't necessarily see face to face.
Okay.
So so like cast members, you'll see them perform, but you might not know where they're
you
from.
You don't see their name badge when they're on stage.
So there are quite a few cast members or performers that are from the U.S. throughout the fleet. Sometimes a lot of the youth staff will be from the United States as well. And I mean, that's a very specific position that needs to have a degree in childcare or in education or something like that. So that is another one that you'll see a higher percentage of. I've seen a lot of American crew staff, and I'm speaking more of the entertainment side of things. I mean, technician, stage staff, all of that, you know, because that is part of our culture. Live theater is a very big part of an American culture. So that's why entertainment side, we have a, I'm not going to say a predominant presence, but a healthier presence of American crew members versus other areas. And when it comes to why there is either maybe not a lot or whatever the case might be, I mean, you got to say you're working on board, away from home, away from families. It's just, I think it's a culture thing, quite honestly. It's something that you have to be able to say, I'm willing to go away for this long to do this job.
Leave your family, your kids.
Exactly.
That's not an American thing to do.
Exactly. Yeah, I mean, I think it just boils down to the culture of it, really. There are cultures out there that it is part of their culture. It is something that is very common. You know, when you're a kid, you see your parents going off to work, they come home, you grow up, you go off to go, you know what I mean? It's not a standard 9 to 5 in some other cultures, where obviously in the U.S., I'm not going to say everyone, but I would say a generalization would be it's a 9 to 5 upbringing.
Now, if somebody's looking at getting started on cruise lines, I mean, a lot of people watch these videos and they want to come on and actually be crew staff themselves. Where's a good place for them to start?
That's another great question. I can kind of briefly tell you how I did it.
Okay.
Because it's a bit different. So out there in the world, there are hiring partners or agencies that will recruit. In the U.S., we actually don't have one of those. So the one way Americans will get hired is just by submitting their resume or CV or cover letter to the company themselves. I mean, that's a lot of people that submit. So yes, you know, obviously there's a team that goes through that. Personally, for me, I went through the Canadian hiring partner.
Okay.
And so I submitted all my stuff. I got an interview. They then passed my name along to Royal Caribbean in regards to their HR hiring onboarding team. They then interviewed me and then went from there. So I would say try and find a local hiring partner or agency, recruiting agency, mm-hmm. in whatever country you are from. I mean, if you are American, potentially look at Canadian hiring partners, because that's how I did it. And it's probably a bit more of a streamlined process than, you know, just emailing through a link the resume.
Subscribing to the black hole, as some people say it, or, you know, applying. And that's true on any job board these days.
Yeah,
any
absolutely.
Job board.
It's one of those things where it's sometimes, you know, it just keywords, if it sifts it automatically, but someone might be super qualified that really needs that person-to-person interaction.
Awesome. Well, Chris, I certainly appreciate you coming on today, taking a moment out of, I know, a hectic schedule.
Yes.
You're greeting 8,000 guests every single week here on the Freedom of the Seas. So certainly appreciate you taking time to come. And so everybody, this is Brandon, the Weekend Cruiser, hoping to see you on a Weekend Cruise soon.